all praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our Lord, the gracious, the merciful, the master of the earths and the heavens, the king of the day of judgment, Azza wa Jal. And the prayers and the blessings of the Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala be upon our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and be upon all those who follow in the footsteps of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. نشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدًا عبد الله ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وخليله اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على الحبيب المصطفى وعلى آله وصحبه ومن استنى بسنته وسار على هديه إلى يوم الدين. We bear witness that there is no Lord but the Almighty Allah سبحانه وتعالى, and that Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم is the messenger of Allah. I remind myself and remind my brothers and sisters to be pious, to be God conscious, to be mindful of the orders of the Almighty Azza wa Jal, and to heed His orders when He says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ حَقَّ تُقَاتِهِ وَلَا تَمُوتُنَّ إِلَّا وَأَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَلْتَنْظُرْ نَفْسٌ مَّا قَدَّمَتْ لِغَدٍ وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ إن الله خبير بما تعملون. O who you believe, be God conscious and die in no way except in the way of Islam. O who you believe, be God conscious and let every soul be aware of its own tomorrow. And fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for He knows best what you do. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to instill taqwa in our hearts, to keep us steadfast, to enable us to remain on the path of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and to be worthy of His mercy subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to be in the Jannah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahumma ameen. My dear respected brothers and sisters, I wanted to share with you some reflections on verses in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that talks about tests and trials and tribulations that people of faith will face. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Ankabut at the beginning, بعد بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ألف لام ميم أحسب الناس أن يتركوا أن يقولوا آمنا وهم لا يفتنون ولقد فتنا الذين من قبلهم فلا يعلمن الله الذين صدقوا ولا يعلمن الكاذبين. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, do people think that they will be left to say that they believe and they are not tested? For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will test and has tested those who are before them, so that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows those who are truthful and those who are not. When we look at these challenges and we look at the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in his early phase, when he was faced with hostility and hardship in his own native home in Mecca, and when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Isra describes his status sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he says, وَإِن كَادُوا لَيَسْتَفِزُّونَكَ مِنَ الْأَرْضِ لِيُخْرِجُوكَ مِنْهَا. They have caused you so much grievance and challenge, and they were about to kick you out of your home. So when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was given guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to seek his guidance, he prayed sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with the prayer a few verses later, when he says, وَقُلْ رَبِّي أَدْخِلْنِي مُدْخَلَ صِدْقٍ وَأَخْرِجْنِي مُخْرَجَ صِدْقٍ وَاجْعَلْ لِي مِنْ لَدُنْكَ سُلْطَانًا نَصِيرًا. He prayed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give him a pathway, a gateway in which he will enter into a matter that will give him truthfulness and strength, and to enable him to exit from his hardships in a way that will provide him also truthfulness, peace, and the ability to remain steadfast. And he asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to provide him the strength and the support to do that. This verse was in fact a verse that came in most of the scholars' tafsirs to signify his path to leave Mecca and to go to Medina. And then in Medina, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he started building the things that were necessary for him in order for him to implement his mission, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and achieve his goals and fulfill the endowed mission of the divine guidance that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed upon him. Now, why am I drawing parallels, my dear brothers and sisters? There are specific points that I want to highlight in our own reality that speaks to the story of our beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You see, when we talk about the challenges that we face, there could be a lot of ways in which we are tested, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's protection from hardship and protection from fitan and protection from the weakness of the soul. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to instill within us the strength to remain steadfast. Subhanallah, if you read those verses in Surah Al-Isra, when he was told about his challenge with those who are trying to give him hardship and kick him out, then you see verses that are referencing وَأَقِمِ الصَّلَةِ, and it references to Qur'an al-Fajr, إِنَّ Qur'an al-Fajr كَانَ مَشْهُودًا, and references to make salah in the night, قِيَامُ اللَّيْلِ, and references to make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to find your path out from the challenges you have. So it always starts with that relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with looking within and making sure that the faith is at its best and it's being nurtured and developed and grown. But then let us assess, when we look at the challenges around us, we find many. Some that are internal, some that are external. Some of them are common stay from the experience we have, and some of them are more complex. And I would like to highlight some of those that are less seen or less perceived, maybe. We all know that we're challenged in raising our children and ensuring that we balance this overwhelming materialism with spirituality and the connection to our faith. We're always challenged by the plight of the youth and having the identity that balances their Islamic principles and their reality and circumstances, Americans. We're challenged with the breakdown in the social fabric of the family and the society. And like it or not, these are our own challenges just as much as the society we live in. But we have prescriptions through which we can solve them. But that's not what I want to talk about today. We can talk about the common external challenges, where we can look at the difficulties that comes with being involved in this big cycle that consumes the human being, the poverty and the challenges that it brings about. Even the xenophobia and the racism and the fear and the hate and the lack of knowledge about Islam and so on and so forth. And maybe those are related to some of these complex ones, but they are general in their nature and they require a lot from us to do. But when we genuinely look, my dear brothers and sisters, to the more complex internal and external challenges, we see two things that I want to reference to the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and to the experience he went through. One of the challenges we have, which is at the core of all this, is how can we, as people who are endowed by the divine guidance of the Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala, who have the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is the guidance to all of humanity, who have the story of the beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with its details, the most detailed and documented human being in the history of mankind, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how can we make it relevant within our own context? How do we take this, have an original reading of the sacred text, the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the sunnah of the beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and make it relevant within the very context we live in, 21st century America? And that's a job that nobody else can do but us. And so that remains at the core of how do we make this divine guidance relevant in very real terms, in very meaningful pathways that allows us to be building towards introducing that faith to the rest of humanity and using it as a way to uplift and improve on the human condition. And that's a challenge that we see today being challenged by not only the external factors, which we will come to, but the internal factors. There are those who are diluting the meaning of our Islam. There are those who want to corner our Islam into the private sector or into the spiritual realm outside of the application in the outside. There are people who are using their billions and billions to introduce a foreign strand of Islam to the American Muslims because they don't want them to be part of the arc of justice that not only will, inshallah, brighten the days of America with justice, but will also bring down the injustice, the dictatorships, the tyranny, and the endless violence that is taking place in the birthplace of so many of us. We need to be careful and we need to pay attention. Even those who claim to be scholars today are meeting with people who are inflicting harm and injustice upon our brothers and sisters everywhere in the name of societal peace and not in the name of justice, which is the very essence of what our deen is about. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَقَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا رُسُلَنَا بِالْبَيِّنَاتِ وَأَنزَلْنَا مَعَهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْمِيزَانَ لِيَقُومَ النَّاسُ بِالْقِسْطِ. And so we need to pay attention and we need to make sure that our Islam is the Islam that is in the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and in the sunnah and the practice of the beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we need to make sure that it's preserved and it remains true to its principles. Yes, we may live in a society where there's a public sphere and there's a private sphere, and we understand the circumstances of a multicultural and multi-religious and a pluralistic society. But we need to be true for our deen. We need to be the ones who define the terms of our deen. We need to be the ones that shape the definition and the application of that deen and not have somebody else define it for us. And so that requires commitment, that requires knowledge, that requires scholarship, and that requires a community that is on the heart of one man. And there's much to be said about that, but maybe we will do in a separate, inshallah, occasion. The last that I want to focus on and tie it to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the external challenges we're facing. When we hear the president of this nation talk about what he's trying to do with the census, some of us may not appreciate the deeper angles of this. When we talk about this constant attack on immigrants and immigration and xenophobia that is rampant, and when we hear these last tweets about 4 Americans, 2 of which are Muslim Americans, or 2 of whom are Muslim Americans, and when we hear the rhetoric of go back to where you came from and so on and so forth, this hate-filled messaging, we recognize that the challenge is existential. And it's something that's very important to tie into the history of this land and to the plight of this land as well. You see, America is a human experiment that brought people from all over the world. It was based on universalist, egalitarian principles declared in the Declaration of Independence, something we just celebrated a few weeks ago. When we said all people are created equal and they're endowed by their creator by inalienable rights, amongst those are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And when we recognize that this story of America is one that is about all of us, that immigration is not just part of America, immigration is America. And so we, as endowed Muslims, by the divine guidance of the Almighty Azza wa Jal, who are becoming part of this experiment, what is it that we have within us that gives us the perspective and gives us the insight that allows us not only to enhance and improve on, but to lead the health and the robustness of this experiment? I want to take you back to the year 627, Gregorian. It's the first year of Hijrah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he arrived to Medina, he did three things that are foundational upon which he built the society in Medina. He built the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Al-Masjid al-Nabawi. And he made it the centerpiece of not only governance, but of all aspects of life. Society revolved around the glorification of the Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he did what is known as al-mu'akha bayn al-muhajirin wal-ansar. He laid the foundations about the relationship of those who have migrated and those who were the natives or those who have lived in Medina. And then he did a third thing that is unparalleled in the history of mankind, that we don't emphasize enough, but through the prism of our American experience, we need as Muslim Americans to highlight it even more. He established what was called then Al-Wathiqa, Wathiqatul Madina Al-Munawwara, which is effectively the first constitution that was established based on a society. You see, the society in Medina was different from the society in Mecca. In Mecca, it was one uniform tribal unit, came from different houses of the same grandfathers and the same forefathers. But in Medina, the city that he chose, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, to live in, to practice in, and to die in, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and made it his home, and made it tied to his own mission and message, and the implementation and the actualization of that faith, was Al-Madinah Al-Munawwara. This was a city that was a commercial city. It was the intersection of multiple cultures, religions, and ethnic backgrounds. Medina, long time ago, in the first century, was occupied by the Jews who escaped persecution that has taken place in Iraq and in the lands of Palestine and so on and so forth. And many of them and many of their tribes stayed. Many of the tribes came from Yemen as well, Al-Aws and Khazraj, and those who came. And then because of its commercial pathways, it used to be a place when people come and stay. And so when he came upon the Medina sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he found a multicultural, multi-ethnic, multi-religious even. Now granted, after he sent his emissaries sallallahu alayhi wasallam, they brought light into the hearts of most. And so the vast majority now became Muslim. Even some of the Jews converted to Islam. Abdullah ibn Salam and many of the scholars of the Judaic faith. But then when he sallallahu alayhi wasallam constructed the foundation upon which to build this new polity, this new state, a reflection and a reading into the Wathiqa is truly amazing. You see in it the fact that he established citizenship sallallahu alayhi wasallam and unity, not based on faith, not based on ethnicities, not based on any geographic orientation, but rather on the fact that all people are equal and that they're part of the same polity and that they exercise rights and freedoms across the board in the way they worship, in the way they believe, in the way they practice, and that they have common duties and responsibilities, that of common defense, that for standing for justice, and not being transgressors, and enjoining the good and forbidding the evil, and coming as one hand against those who transgress, and protecting every element of that society. It's amazing, even in some statements where he talks, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, about what we today perceive as social security. There's an actual term within the watiqa that says for those who are overwhelmed because of poverty, or those who are overwhelmed because they rear big families, we shall provide them the means to live in dignity and to live equal. And so out of that experiment was born truly the first human experiment where people came together and lived and achieved a civilization that lasted 1,000 years. My dear brothers and sisters, people who come from that tradition, people who say La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah every single day, and who look at the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as our ultimate model and guide. لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. Far from it, my dear brothers and sisters, will we give up on what we believe in? And would we give up because of the rhetoric and the nonsense that's being spewed? Because when we look at the interpretation that is trying to define the soul of America today, when we look at what we call the universalist interpretation of the Declaration of Independence, not the ethnic one, not the religious one, not the white one, not the Christian one, but rather the one that was the very spirit that established this human experiment we call America, we can very easily draw the parallels. We can always feel the pride of being there, done that 1400 years ago almost. A tradition that made Umar radiallahu anhu be the man when he went onto a multicultural, multi-religious city, as in the city of Jerusalem. It was very easy for him, radiallahu anhu wa ardah, to not impose or not persecute and not create injustice. It came to the time when it was time for Salatul Asr, and he was in the middle of the largest church in which he was meeting the Christian leaders of Jerusalem. He would even think not to pray in the same church because he was afraid that there will be people who can interpret his prayer as a way of taking over that church. And he would walk across the path and he would pray in what's today Al-Masjid Al-Umari, across the street practically. It was the same that allowed the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he met the Christians of Najran, to be able to draft something that was revolutionary, if you look at it in today's world's items, and in which he would do words and statements that are beyond even his time, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But in fact, it was the product of that revolution. My dear brothers and sisters, when we look at this traditions, when we look at that faith, we are imbibed with the energy and the zeal and the interest and the dedication to fix that which is wrong with our country, to be part of the solution, to be able to draft and envision a future that can be based on the divine guidance of the Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that will bring healing and unity amongst the very home we call home today. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to enlighten our hearts, to keep us steadfast, to enable us to be able to be the ones who will introduce truthfulness and goodness to this nation, and be the ones who will allow the hate and vile to exit from our communities and our societies. We shall remain steadfast. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala his forgiveness. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ فَاسْتَغْفِرُوا إِنَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. الحمد لله رب العالمين حمدا كثيرا طيبا مباركا فيه والصلاة والسلام على الحبيب المصطفى وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. My dear brothers and sisters, those challenges that I'm referring to are real. They're gripping our nation, and if we fail to provide a discourse and a vision that allows us all to travel in the same ship, we may very much find a lot of conflict and hate and problems. And so we need to learn to be inspired and invoke the very principles, the very best that we can bring to this American experiment, and be able to be the leaders that are imbibed by the experiences of their beloved sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the historic richness and pride in the civilization that has been brought about on the basis of these divine foundations, and be able to infuse the American experiment and crown it with that divine guidance. It is the call of our time, my dear brothers and sisters. And we shall inshallah embrace, but don't be oblivious, nor do you think that these problems do not exist. And fortunately, there's those who fan the flames of hate, and they have no vision or no pathway for us to ensure the health and the steadfastness of our society. It is true that today, in terms of those who are born in this country, this is a minority-majority country, my dear brothers and sisters. We may not see it in the power echelons. We may not see it in the U.S. Congress yet. But the fact of the matter is that it is more than 50% of those who are born today in the United States of America are of minorities. In 2020, more than 50% of those who are under the age of 18, this is next year, will be of the minority majorities. You and I and everybody else in this room, along with everybody else who's in America. And in 2040, more than 50% of every American will be of the minority majorities. If we want to ensure the health and the wellness of this community and of the country we live in and we love, then we must be, inshallah, leading the solution, bringing forth the bridges of humanity and the bridges of the oneness of our humanity that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordained upon us. We need to be the ones, inshallah, that bring the healing with the vision, with the patience, with the love and compassion, as well as the courage and the strength to remain in the cause of justice and in the cause of human family. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us the strength and the iman and the faith to remain steadfast on this path, and to allow us to face evil and stop it, and to allow us to remain strong in the face of adversity, and to allow us to be victorious and able, inshallah, to chart the right path for our nation. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgiveness and guidance. Allahumma afu anna waghfir lana warhamna. Anta maulana fansurna ala alqawmi alkafirin. Allahumma ahdina wahdi bina. Allahumma ati nufusana taqwaha. Wazakkiha maulaya. Anta khayru man zakkaha. Anta waliyaha wa maulaha. Ibadallah. Inna allaha ya'muru bil adli wal ihsani wa ita'idil qurba. Wa yanha anil fahshai wal munkari wal baghi. Ya'idhukum la'allakum tadakkaroon. Fadkurullaha yadkurkum. Wad'uhu yastajib lakum. Waladhikrullahi أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون وقوموا إلى الصلاة يرحمكم الله وأقم الصلاة.